Morning. Welcome. I didn't mean to scare you this morning like I did. Kind of scared me too. The Holy Ghost got me this morning already. Anyway, welcome to our service this morning. It's good to see each one of you here this morning. We just pray that you come to worship God, praise Him, glorify His name, hear what He has to say to you this morning. But not only here, take it, put it in your heart. Use it this coming week. Because the field is out there. Church is in here. When we leave those doors, that's our mission field. No matter where you are. IHOP, Waffle House, anywhere. Walmart. That's our field. And you don't ever know when God's going to open that door to you. And as Christians, we need to be ready. And if you may say something wrong, God will take care of it. He'll work with you. Again, welcome to our service, especially our guests, our visitors. We're all glad to have you with us this morning. We pray that you take that visit card and fill it out. Place that in an offering later when we have a little record of your visit with us. Also, welcome to our own members. Glad to have you here this morning. Basically, I have only one announcement. We're still in the middle of the George Barnett Missions offering. We have the G.
Yay!
Remember last Sunday, we used the acronym, it's 15 letters. Our goal is $1,500. Every $100, we're going to spell out her name, Georgia Barnett. So we got the G. Amen. 14 more to go, though, people. Well, we're in gathering this morning, but I know we just announced it last Sunday. So money's going to come in. Some reason, somehow, God, we make our goal, go over our goals. So keep that in mind so we can further the missions offering. So we're going to have a video of the George Barnett missions offering.
No disaster relief. For 25 years, Howard Turner and his team have served disaster victims in 26 states and 6 countries. Recipients of the Hannah Reynolds WFU Scholarship received more than financial assistance. They also received prayer support from local WMU groups and associations. Students from Louisiana BCMs have led VBS in small and rural churches. Over 15,000 children and workers have participated in the GOLA-led VBS. Million lost people in Louisiana. Here for You enables us to meet them in a place where they spend 44% of their waking hours.
Down here.
Thank you for the video. You know, when we can't go ourselves, we go to our money. And God provides us the money and the ability to do that. So when you make your donations to the George Bennett offering, you're going. So the Spirit is going with you. So pray. We will have a little formal in-gathering during our fellowship time this morning, but also you can give anytime the next coming weeks. So keep that in mind. Pray about how much you feel God is going to allow you to give, and you can give more than one time. Give today, next Sunday, following Sunday. So keep that in your prayers. Also, I'd like to say we're going to start our CEF at Dillon School this coming Thursday. Well, you don't know, it's a true evangelism fellowship, also known as the Good News Club, because we teach the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Last spring, we had 28 enrolled, average attendance of 24. Don't know yet how many enrolled yet for this fall, but that's one of the highest enrollment we've had so far since I've been there the last 10 years. So keep that in prayer, that you be with us as leaders, that everything we do, our demeanor, what we say, how we act around those kids, they'll see Jesus. They'll see Jesus in us. And then as we teach them, the music, the lesson, everything to do to teach the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're not to plant that seed. And we know, we never know how that seed's going to grow, who's going to water it later on. But if we plant a seed, God's word said it will not come back void. So we'll start that this coming Thursday. I don't know when the other school's going to start there, but I'm sure it'll be pretty soon also. At Riser also. Miss Penny is working on that riser, so the prayers also. Without further ado, let's stand and have our call of worship. Great is the Lord, hymn number 12. Just one time through. Go and say, we stand and sing hymn number 12. Great is the Lord. Our time of fellowship. If you like, across the aisle, welcome each one to our service, or you turn in and wave, whatever you like to do. Thank you. way back where he started from, and look at Singapore, course. There's something about that name. Number 177. There's something about that name. Go ahead and sing. Jesus has been around for 2,000 years and is stronger today than it was then. And we still remember it. 2,000 years, all those people, forgot about them. Something about that name. Worthy of worship. We're going to sing page 3, all 3 verses. The song hadn't sung in a while, but should be singing more often. That's my fault there, too. God's always worthy of our worship, worthy of our praise. We're going to sing all 3 verses. Hymn number 3, you need a hymn book. Worthy of worship.
Part of
Amen. This next song, another one, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. I'd like to let you know that we are fixing to sing classical music because the music was written by Ludwig van Beethoven, also known as Ode to Joy. But in our hymn book, it's called Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Hymn number 7, we're going to sing all 3 verses together. Join us. Hymn number 7, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. The joy divine. Our next hymn, How Great Thou Art, we ask that you stand and sing all 4 verses together. And number 10, How Great Thou Art. Join us in the singing. All 4 verses.
I hear the rolling thunder. touch those leading, Lord. For Kyle, Lord, bless him, God, with your word. Bless Brother Bill, Lord. I pray that these songs would glorify your name, Lord. And it would be something that you enjoy hearing, God. Thank you, Lord, for this offering, Lord. I pray, Lord, that we use it wisely, Lord, to pray your name. I pray your blessings upon us.
Love you so much. Sometimes we don't act it, but so many things you've done for us, your goodness in our life, your blessing in our life, and just to see Brother Lloyd here this morning is a blessing itself. Praise to you. We thank you for the service up to now, Lord. We pray that the song has been receptive and good to your sight and your ears. Pray, Lord, now for our offering, take it, bless it, use it to your glory. Spread your word, your gospel, Lord. Pray, Brother David, as he comes and sings for us, that you fill him with your spirit, that you sing through him, that you go through him. And Brother Kyle, as he comes and brings the bread of life to us, that our hearts will be receptive to your word for us. We take it in and hide it in our heart, and as we leave this place this morning, we're renewed, stronger, be ready to be a witness to those about us this coming week. Also, Lord, we do pray that someone may be here today that does not know you as their personal Savior, that the Spirit be free to move in their hearts, prick their hearts, start a movement, see a real need of you in their life, a life-changing event, and ask you to come in their hearts this morning as we say that they have salvation for them. In all things, Lord, we do want to give you the praise, the honor, and glory. Just thank you for once again coming this time together. We can come worship you together. In Jesus' name we pray. Have a young fellow been coming for a couple of Sundays now, and David LaRocca, and he's going to sing a song for us, and I'll let him talk to you about it.
I don't really have anything special to say before I start singing, so okay.
Seems like all I could see was a struggle, haunted by ghosts that lived in my past, bound up in shackles of all my failures, wondering how long is this gonna last? But you look at this prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting a fight that's already been won. And I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. I'm redeemed. All my life I've been called unworthy. Named by the voice of my shame and regret. But when I hear you whisper, child, lift up your head. I remember, oh God, you're not done with me yet. And I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. I'm not who I used to be, because I don't have to be the old man inside of me, because his day is long dead and gone, because I've got a new name, a new life, I'm not the same, and a hope that will carry me home. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. I'm not who I used to be. Oh God, I'm not who I used to be. Jesus, I'm not who I used to be. Because I am redeemed. Thank you, God, with you.
Thank you.
You may not believe this, but I'm kind of at a loss for words. And, just praise the Lord. Let's get still before God for a minute in prayer. Father, we would be remiss if we started anywhere else other than just with a thank you, praising your holy name. Father, I pray that we never forget, Lord, that you didn't have to love us. You are not obligated to love us. You are not obligated to make a way, to that we spend eternity with you in heaven. But God, you desired that we do so. And Father, before the foundation of this world, God, you made a plan in your Son Jesus Christ and his atoning death on the cross. God, you tell us in your word, Father, that that's the only way. And that may not seem simple in our minds, but it is simple because we must first come to a realization that we can't do it ourselves. That we're absolutely and completely and utterly helpless apart from you. Humbling ourselves. Looking to you, calling upon you. Recognizing our sin. Recognizing the one that died for our sin, the price that was paid, and repenting of our sin. Oh God, this day, Father, as we look, Lord, at your word, God, I pray that our minds would be still before you and we not be, God, just looking ahead to the events of the afternoon of maybe ball games that we're going to watch on TV or food to be prepared or friends that we're going to meet with, all these things, God, that we just set aside, Lord, and just right now, just humble ourselves and yield to your word. Amen. God, for there be anyone here today that's lost, dear God, the subject matter of which we're going to cover in just a few moments, Father, I pray that it not pass them by, Lord, without spiritual recognition. The dangers, the traps of this world. Father, I just pray, God, your Holy Spirit convict that heart. Father, for every Christian here, God, I pray that we would never be spiritually arrogant in our lives or before you, but God, that we always recognize, understand the importance of humbling ourselves before you, yielding to your word, yielding to your authority. God, you know every heart here this morning. You know the things that we're struggling with ourselves as an individual. The areas of our life, Father. We're facing decisions, events, things, God, even though, Lord, we may be saved, areas, Father, that we've not just let go of and trusted you. Oh, God, I just pray right now that our heart, the desire of our heart, would be to let go and trust you in everything. It's in Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Amen. Turning to your Bible again, the book of James chapter 4. We're going to read just a little bit of the area that we've already covered, but it's necessary because of where this is guiding us to in this passage. We are going to primarily today focus on one of the, what I believe to be, what I see, examples in 30 years, plus years in the ministry and its effect upon families, its effect upon people, the destructive force. I'm going to primarily today focus on one of two areas of things that, shall we say, that not to say that there isn't more, but one of two areas that we face every single waking moment in the day that we live. And those two areas, again, are shall we say, they're guided by images that we see, by things that we watch, the entertainment that we choose for ourselves, the movies that we watch. We need to understand, folks, that Hollywood's design is not to make stuff to entertain you, to be wholesome and to be good, this, that, and the other, but Hollywood's design is, shall we say, the result of their nature, their satanic nature, and it is to destroy them. And it's amazing to me in the day that we live in and the trash that we see on TV and this, that, and other, the things that God clearly condemns, and we let it in our households and we say, you know what, I know where the line is and I'm going to be real careful. Can I tell you, you've already messed up by letting it in on your house?
Come
on. Well, you know, Pete, preacher, the modern day we live in, you know, preacher down the road, he said it was okay. I'm not worried about what the preacher down the road says. I'm worried about what the Word of God says.
Come on, preacher.
I can't tell you how many preachers over the years have that I've been involved with have done things and said things in reference to people that I know personally that directly contradict the Word of God. You say, well, what does that mean? That means that preacher is out of the will of God.
Right.
Y'all hear what I just said?
That's right. Come on.
And strong possibility that he ain't even saved. But there are two things that affect you and attack you every waking moment of your life right now. One that we'll not speak about today is false teaching. False teachers, though it certainly could be included in some of this we're looking at. But the other is worldliness. Worldliness. I've watched over the years how applications to this word have filled in a lot of blanks, and a lot of stuff has come to mean, shall we say, worldliness. Let me start with this first. The worldliness that the Bible speaks of is not, shall we say, just contained in or relegated to one, like say, an activity. You did something, okay, and so now you're of the world. That's not what Scripture teaches. Certainly, there are things in this world that are alluring,
right,
even to a child of God.
Right.
Amen. There's things out there that sparkle.
Come on.
How many of you have ever been to the honey hole? Hold your hand. Well, that's a pretty good number. If you go back there on that back row, that's my favorite row. I think my name's up there somewhere. You go back there on that back row, there's white perch, jigs, everything you can imagine up and down both sides. And you got beautifully covered plastics and beautifully covered feathers and all these different kinds of things and different color heads. But you know what's in the middle of all that? A hook. See, you drop that old jig down in that treetop, dangle that thing down there in front of his nose, and he's not looking for the hook.
Right.
You hear what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. He's looking at, ooh, looky here. That's the best looking shiner I ever seen in my life.
Amen.
And it's too late. Folks, can I tell you that Satan does the same thing in this world? He dangles things in front of your eyes that look so good. Man, I just thought that over there was good.
That's right.
His here's a lot better. I'm going to give you in just a few moments a more in-depth definition of worldliness. But let's read our text here this morning in James chapter 4. I'm going to start reading verse number 1. I'm not going to cover this ground again. I've anchored here in the first three verses the last 2 weeks. We're going to move into 4. Verse 1 says, from whence come wars and fightings among you? That's church folk. Come they not hence, even of your own lust, your own desires, that war in your members? That's not church members, that's bodily members. Eyes, ears, hands, and things we do, our imaginations, our mind, our heart. Verse 2 says, you lust and have not, and you kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you have not because you ask not. We spoke about that in last week. Verse 3 says, you ask and receive not because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your own lust. Understanding first that the asking first must come complete obedience and submission to the Word of God itself. speaking to God, calling upon God in His terms. Now, can I just say to you, if you had a notebook right now, if you had something you could write on, I would ask you to jot down calling upon God upon His terms and His alone. Just kind of jot that down somewhere, even if it's in your mind. Then take that, and in your prayer life, speak to God about this. In the Holy Word of God, as He speaks to you, and as He shows you again what this means and its teachings, you'll be permeated. You will be absolutely permeated. Not in one night, folks.
Right.
Not in one week. Not in one month. But over the course of the rest of your life, you will be permeated by what God is teaching here. Pray according to His commandments, how He says we must approach Him. Can I tell you that we live in a world that's so fast-paced, and I'm talking about spiritually at the moment, that we think that we've already done everything that we need to do, that we're already saved. I know all that stuff. Let's move on. I got to hurry. Let me tell you something. You're hurrying right past the things in this world that God wants for you.
Amen.
You're hurrying right past obedience unto Him. Worldliness. Verse number 4 here, could pick it up or read it. Says, ye adulterers and adulteresses. This is spiritual adultery. Know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? How is that singing here? Know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore would be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Whoa, wait a minute. Seems to me I've read some stuff here, there, and yonder about the enemies of God. And if you've read the Word of God much, you have. Do you know that a born-again Christian is never, ever referred to in Scripture as the enemy of God?
Amen.
Not one time. Not one time. So what is the enemy of God? It's not just somebody that don't do what God says. It's somebody that's lost.
That's right.
It's someone that's lost. It's not saved. Friendship of the world is enmity with God. Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God.
Amen.
Let's talk about worldliness here just a minute. Now, as I start down this list, you're immediately going to recognize the things that bombard you every day. You may realize it. You may not realize, shall we say, the incredible negative importance of issues, of things that you hear constantly on the radio, things that you hear constantly on TV, whatever the case may be, commercials. It's amazing to me, and I don't even have cable TV, satellite TV anymore.
Amen.
But let me just tell you, pay attention in the right way to commercials. Because they all have an agenda.
That's right.
Yesterday on my phone, I was watching some, checking in on football. I have a weakness. It's college football. Okay. I cannot help myself, okay? And I mean, I got to know what's going on from the first kickoff to the last one. If I wake up, like I did last night at 2:15, I'm going to check the scores of the late game. I'm sorry. But one of the commercials that I kept watching it on YouTube on my phone yesterday during the Razorback game, that I wish I hadn't even said the word. I just sinned right there, went in and fled. One of the things that I kept seeing, I saw this commercial about four times yesterday in total, here, there, and yonder, was a commercial about staying at the Hilton. Listen, this is just one. Y'all do understand that any time you see in a motel, hotel room, two guys sitting on a bed, that they're promoting sodomites. Y'all understand that? And they just flash it by, and they get, you know, they're so loving. Well, I'm going to tell you what they are. They hate it straight to hell.
Amen. Tell them.
Commercials are about indoctrination. Indoctrination by Satan himself. Now, let's talk about worthiness. I said, well, I thought you'd been talking about worthiness. I ain't got started yet. Hold your place here. And we're going to go to 1 John chapter 2. And then we're coming back. So 1 John chapter 2. John chapter 2, three verses, beginning in verse 15. It says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. And if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Back to James 4. Talk about worldliness. Let me give you my definition. As I've composed this over the years by different things. So just kind of listen with your heart, with your ears. He that hath an ear, let him hear. Worldliness is the love of materialism. It's a mindset. It's a political correctness. It's society's values, society's idea of right and wrong. Worldliness is, shall we say, in a sense, it's a wall that comes up in the heart, okay, shall we say, every instant when facing God's truth. Worldliness is a philosophy. It's a mental preoccupation that is 180 degrees opposite from all that is holy. Amen. It is a mental, intellectual busyness of events, fads, pop culture, music, advertising, marketing, socially acceptable conversations. Did y'all just hear what I just said? Because you need to understand that's coming here in America, where you will be restricted by our government by the things that you can talk about. The UN, which is in itself a sepulcher of Satan, made a statement this week that in order for us to have commonality, that means one world government, we must restrict and censor the words of the masses. Now, folks, this isn't new. This has been going on for a long time. But if you really want to, if we have this discussion, we have to do it with all the phones cut off. In America, it started in 1929, and we'll get to that another time. Worldliness. It's an automatic acceptance to the narrative. You realize that 5 years ago, didn't nobody in America even didn't know what the word narrative meant? You hear what I'm saying? I said, not necessarily don't know what it meant, but I mean, it wasn't a commonly used term, but boy, it is now. That means that they control what they want you to see, what you think, your words, society's movements. They control the story. It's an automatic acceptance to the narrative of media. If you ain't figured out right now that our national media, and understand, our local media is owned by national media companies. Does anybody understand that? The information they're giving you that information because that's what they want to tell you. To manipulate your mind. Manipulate what is right and wrong. What is, what is not. It's satanic. Narrative of media. Ungodly politicians. And education. This mindset, attitude of the heart, accepts and agrees with the prevailing world demands. Now, the first time that I ever read this list would be actually 3 years ago this coming December at a pastor's conference in Texas. And so anyway, as I've looked at it, it's very interesting to watch how these, shall we say, these points become more and more important and understood the further we go through time. Because then this was certainly true, but it wasn't like everybody knew, and now it's different. Listen. We will, that means the governments of the world, the elite. We will tell you what you can say, what you can do, where you can go, what you can buy, what you can drive. We will decide for you what is right and wrong, how you can raise your children, what you can teach your children. Do you realize that three different times, just in the last 165 days, three times, okay, one of these is in Rhode Island, I believe, the second one is in Arizona, and I'm not sure, completely sure about the third, but I think it's Texas. I know for sure the first two. But do you realize that three different times in the past year, either people, shall we say, highly placed in teachers' unions or attorney for a teacher's union or a teacher themselves have said publicly and on record that parents, when you send your children, oh, and I forgot about that so-called president we have, but when you send your children to public school, you lose your rights as a parent. Now, we can sit here and say, I don't agree with that unless you do something about it.
That's right.
Amen. Talk's cheap. Can I tell you that that has been the design of the NEA, the National Education Association, since its inception? And that principle goes back all the way to the 1930s. And it's actually, shall we say, conjoined with the classrooms of the SS. That's where it comes from. Worldliness, it is a mental and spiritual rejection of all things that are God. It is not only a rejection of truth, but a rejection of all truth that exists. That truth changes relative to your circumstances. Worldliness is an absolute and complete rejection of God's authority over the individual. It is an allegiance to satanic thought. Worldliness is a manifestation of the satanic nature of his children. I'm coming back to that in just a minute. We're not going to turn there. We don't have time to turn there. But I do want to give you what I believe to be the strongest biblical example of worldliness. And we see this example based on what someone does, and shall we say, based on that same individual, what they don't do. Understandably, because of what I've just told you, what they don't do is obey God. And what they do is obey Satan. Obey their own nature. And the strongest example that I know of Scripture, in Scripture, of, shall we say, worldliness and love of this world occurs in the book of Genesis. You know the story, if you spend any time in the Word at all, if you've ever been in church much time at all, you remember that there was a point in time where basically God said, okay, he says, I am going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah because of her wickedness.
Right.
Now, you may not like that, but you can't take it out of the Bible.
That's right. And
the problem is if you are indeed call yourself a child of God and you don't like God being able to do that or to say that or proclaim that, then you've got a problem yourself. But here's what God said. I'm going to destroy it. And he sends two angels, two messengers, again there, to warn Lot. Okay? So they go in and they warn Lot. Then you have the stuff that all happens at Lot's house and all the guys outside trying to press upon because they were going to rape these two men. And the angels, God, through these angels, struck them all. Okay? And so what the messengers told them was, is Lot, you need to gather your family out because in tomorrow morning we're getting out of here. You need to get all your family. So let me tell you real quick what happened right then and there. Lot's heart skipped a beat. What do you mean, preacher? It skipped a beat just like yours would or mine would had we not been a true representative of Jesus Christ, of our Lord and Savior, before the people that we live.
Amen.
You see, Lot was a joke, spiritually. The Bible tells us he was saved. But he lived in the midst of that world and all that trash that was going on in Sodom. He was a part of it all. He didn't speak out against it. He didn't want to rock the boat. He didn't want to cause any waves. Just keep our mouth shut and just kind of let it go by and it don't affect me.
Yeah.
Folks, isn't that where we live right now?
Yeah, that's right.
And so when he went to, the Bible tells us there, that when he went to his sons-in-law, these are those that are married to the other than the two daughters that live with him and his wife. Smartest in the world, I can figure that out.
Amen.
But he went to them and he said, guys, wait a minute, we got to talk. And this is what's the picture to happen. And you know what the Bible says them men did? They laughed at him. They laughed. So then we skip forward. The angels are jerking Lot up out of his bed and said, we got to go. Get your stuff. Get your girls that are here, and let's get your wife, and let's get out of here. And they told him, said, don't look back. And we have, through the years, we've kind of, in our mind, we've formed the idea that Scripture, what it's talking about there is that as they were leaving, that God just simply told them, don't glance. That's not what the Bible says. And when they start out, somebody looked back. And that was?
Lot's wife.
And the word there is not a glance. Now, I can say this one of two ways. Matter of fact, I probably will say it both ways. It's 5-6 minutes after 12. One way would be, okay, if I'm being drug out of Bass Pro Shop with $2,000 still in my pocket to spend, I'm not going to want to go. And the same is true with the woman in the mall or shoe store. I walk in to buy a shoe. I walk in. I know right where it's at. I grab that shoe, grab that thing, go up there, and I sit down up there, and I said, here we go. I'm out.
That's right.
Woo! Roll the rain. You better be careful. But most women don't do it that way. Okay, let's get back to Lot's wife before y'all get in trouble. Lot's wife is being taken out. Lot has her hand. He said, we got to go, we got to go, we got to go. I'm sure he's grabbing Donald. And she's fighting every step of the way because of what she's leaving behind. She loved what she was leaving behind. And that's what controlled her heart. That's what controlled her mind. Folks, that's what worldliness is. A I've got seven verses here, but we're just going to do one. How's that? Let's go back to 1 John. 1 John chapter 3. One of the things that people kind of have a difficult time with sometimes is this principle. Not all people, and when I say people, I'm talking about church folks, I'm talking about saved folks. But I can't tell you how many times people have, preacher, I need to talk to you at church, dude. There's something here you said in this message here that I don't agree with. And then you show them in what God's word says about it, and they still don't agree with you. Well, I'm not the one who has a problem. The Bible tells us there's only two types of children in this world. Every individual is either a child of God or a child of the devil. I know that, and I promise you, I believe I can. I don't think there's anybody in here that's watched more episodes or as many times as the Andy Griffith Show as I have. And I realize that Barney Fife said that we're all God's children, but we ain't.
That's right. Amen.
You're born into a family. Okay? These precious children that are here today, and some of them in their mama's arms, some of them done gone next door. When they were born into a certain family. The Bible teaches us that we were born into a family, but we have we're born with a sin nature.
Amen.
Mamas and daddies, I know. But we're born guilty.
That's right.
We're born guilty. 1 John chapter 3. Verse 10, starting in verse 10, says, in this, I wish we could do the whole chapter. We'll be going through 1st, 2nd, 3rd John at some point down the road. In this, the children of God are manifest, okay, are made visible. And the children of the devil, whosoever doeth not righteousness, is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. For this is the message that ye heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Not as Cain. Now remember Cain. He was the firstborn of Eve. Not as Cain, who was of that wicked one and slew his brother. You say, well, he was of that wicked one because he slew his brother. No, that was his heart before he slew his brother. He was lost. And wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil and his brother's righteous. Backing up one line, worldliness is an allegiance to satanic thought. Worldliness is a manifestation of the satanic nature of his children. I know it's getting late, but this is a crucially, crucially important passage. And we need to understand that Satan is attacking everywhere and everybody to a degree. And those that are lost will completely accept, because of their satanic nature, the things that I've described as worldliness. But listen, Christians, that does not mean that you yourself are not immune. Because the activities of worldliness, the things of this world, are destructive to you. Not in the sense that you're going to lose your salvation. That's not possible. You can possibly lose your life. But one of the things that you will lose, shall we say, the word here has been used manifest, but other people are going to know about it most of the time. It's nothing to do with it. One of the things you will lose is your testimony. And with that testimony, losing that testimony, you're losing with that, shall we say, opportunities and credibility to share Jesus Christ with someone that's lost. or encourage a brother or sister in Christ that's struggling with sin, different things in their life. You will be attacked by worldliness today. I got in the truck this morning. I hadn't changed channels. I still had it on 97.7. Sports channel, folks. I hadn't changed. Every time morning, when that Sunday morning, I leave, okay, to come to church, I turn it on 89.5, BBM, to listen to Warren Wisdom. But it was still on 97.7. You know how long it took as I turned the key on? Less than 3 seconds. Out my speakers of my truck to come that trash attacking from the world in something very specific. Listen to me. Listen to me. We'll move further into this next week, but it is crucially important for every single one of you. Every single one of you that are saved. To have a heart that not once upon a time, once in a while, but all the time, be completely submitted to the authority of the Word of God and the Word of God itself. Amen. If you're here today and you can't say with certainty, I know beyond the shadow of a doubt, I know for sure if I were to die right now, I know I'm going to heaven. Based on what God's Word says. If you can't say that for sure, you can know that before you leave. Before you ever get in your car, you can know that. The Holy Spirit of God will first convict you. So I don't understand that convicting. That convicting part is you, shall we say, and I'm going to use the term feeling, and that's dangerous. But in the sense, feeling a guilt that you didn't have before you got here today. And in your mind and in your heart is racing through your sin. It's racing through things that's not pleasing unto God. It's a part of you that you can't get rid of up on your own. I've tried to clean myself, but I'm not doing any good because you can't.
That's right.
If you don't know for sure, you can know for sure today. And I'm just going to tell you this one more time. I know some of you have heard this many times. You're going to hear every Sunday that I preach here. There's only one way to heaven. Only one. It's not about joining a Baptist church. It's not about that water up there. It's not about money you put in there. It's not about you sitting in that pew. It's about what happens in your heart.
Amen.
Book of John chapter 6 verse 44 says that you don't decide when you get saved just in that sense. But the Holy Spirit of God has to convict you first.
Amen.
And draw you unto Him. Okay? That drawing is in essence a realization of our guilt. And you cannot go to heaven unless you realize that you're guilty. That I'm a sinner. Second of all, by faith. Listen, as was said earlier, Christ was here 2,000 years ago, over 2,000 years ago. Right? None of us here saw Him. None of us here was standing at the cross. None of us here was there whenever the tomb was empty. Okay? But the Word of God tells us, and the Spirit of God tells us that this is true, but we must believe by faith that Jesus Christ died on that cross, not just to die, not just so that there be another religion, but He shed His blood that you and I might have eternal life with Him. But by faith, we must believe that that blood was shed for you and me personally, by name.
Amen.
So what does that mean? That means that He knew every sin you were ever going to commit. Before He ever left heaven, He knew them all. And it's more than 100, it's more than 1,000, it's more than 10,000, it's more than 10,000 times 10,000. But He still loved you. And He still died for you. We must believe by faith that He died for us. Substitutionary atonement is the doctrine. Next is repentance. That conviction tells our heart, tells us, it's that overwhelming, shall we say, and I'm back to the term feeling, and I'm trying to be so cautious with this, because feeling is dangerous if it has anything to do with salvation. But there's an overwhelming sense of guilt. And repentance is knowing that that's who we are, knowing that that's who we are before a holy God, and wanting in a sense we're turning away. That's repentance. And with that heart that yearns to be right with the holy God is a call for God to forgive us of our sin.
Amen.
And call upon Him to save our soul. Be our Lord. God promises us in the book of Romans 10:13 says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, say it together, shall be saved. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Oh God. God, I pray that there not be a single soul walk out this door today without doing in our hearts, by submitting to you, by coming to this altar, by whatever it is. I pray that not a single person would leave here today without doing what you brought us here today to do. In Jesus' name we pray.